Impermanentemente
Om
linked. Om Gyanatamarandasya Gyananjanashalakaya Chakshurunmilitanena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Panchakaupatarubhyascha Kripasindubhayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. Though we're reading Krishna book, we're on chapter number 87. We're hearing the prayers by the personified Vedas.
我们今天继续来阅读 Krishna 快乐的泉源。我们读到第87章《韦达经》的人格化身祈祷。
So we were hearing about the different opulences of Lord Krishna, how Lord Krishna possesses all kinds of transcendental qualities and mystic powers.
我们听到 Krishna 拥有全部的富裕，他拥有玄秘的力量。
And no ordinary person can compare to him.
没有哪个普通人能和他媲美。
So we can understand that the Mayavadi theory that the super soul and the individual soul are equal is wrong.
Mayavadi 所言，超灵和个体灵魂相等的理论是错误的。
The actual conclusion is that Krishna is worshipable.
结论是，Krishna 应受到崇拜。
And all the other living entities are Krishna's servants.
其他所有的生物只是他的仆人而已。
So when we come to this understanding, this is called self-realization.
当我们得出这样的结论，这便称为是自我觉悟。
Any other realization of oneself beyond this is simply Maya.
除此之外，任何其他的自我觉悟都由假象所驱使。
So the last snare of Maya is how Maya dictates to the living entities to try to become equal to God.
假象的最后诱惑，便是指令生物，使生物欲与至尊人格神首平等。
The Mayavadi philosophers, they want to be equal to God.
Mayavadi 哲学家想要和神平等。
But if we ask them, how did it come about that you have fallen into the material world? They cannot answer.
倘若我们反问他，你是又是如何堕进物质世界的呢？他们回答不上来。
If he is actually God, how is it possible that he could be overcome by impure or impious activities?
如果他是神，那他为什么会受不虔诚的活动所困扰？
When they do impious activities, then they're under the law of karma.
一旦他们从事不虔诚的活动，便要遭受业报定律。
So if we ask any Mayavadi about this, they cannot give a proper answer.
如果我们问，曼瓦迪派人士，他们则无法适当的解释。
And they simply speculate to think that they are equal to God.
他们只是在心智推敲，他们和神相等。
So this is another symptom of their sinful life.
这是他们从事罪恶活动的另一个特征。
No one can take to Krishna consciousness unless they're free from all sinful activities.
除非人完全从罪恶活动中解放出来，否则不能得到 Krishna 知觉。
Just the fact that the Mayavadi claims to be one with God means that he's not free from sinful reactions.
马拉瓦蒂派人士声称与神是合一的，这个事实就意味着他们还没有从罪恶活动反应中解放出来。
In the Srimad Bhagavatam, these kind of sinful people are described to be avishuddha buddhaya, means that they think themselves liberated.
圣典波伽瓦坛称这些人是这阿维师的巴达呀，他们误以为自己已经得到解脱。
And they think themselves equal with the absolute truth.
他们同时自以为与绝对真理相等。
But their intelligence is not purified.
他们的智慧没有得到净化。
So the personified Vedas, they say that if the yogis and the jnanis don't get free from sinful desires, then their process of self-realization will never be successful.
伟达诸经的化身说道：“如果瑜伽师和思辨家不把自己从罪恶欲望中解放出来，那他们的自觉程序永不能成功。
So the personified Vedas continued to pray to the Lord.
”伟达经的人格化身继续向主祈祷。
And they said to the Lord, if saintly persons don't take care to remove completely all the roots of sinful desires, then they cannot experience the super soul.
他们说，如果圣人不彻底的消除罪恶欲望的根源，他们便不能知悉超灵。
Although he is sitting, the super soul is sitting side by side with the individual soul, but they cannot experience the super soul.
尽管超灵和个体灵魂是，他们坐在一起。但是他们仍然不能体验到超灵。
Actually, samadhi or meditation means we have to find the super soul within ourselves.
事实上，samadhi 就意味着我们要觉察到内心的超灵。
But if a person is not free from sinful reactions, they won't be able to see the super soul.
倘若一个人没有摆脱罪恶的反应，便不能看见超灵。
Just like if a person has a jeweled lock, they may have a valuable jeweled locket around his neck, but he may forget about the jewel.
这就好比一个人，他的脖子上挂着一个钻石的珠宝盒，但他可能忘记了这颗宝石。
So when he for it's just like he's it doesn't. He doesn't have it anymore. He doesn't think about it. It's like he doesn't have it.
他根本就想不到，就好像他就没有一样。
In the same way, if an individual soul meditates, but he doesn't actually see the presence of the super soul, then his meditation is useless.
同样的，个体灵魂苦苦的冥想，但没有真正看见存在心中的超灵，那么他就。他的冥想就不成功，就没有用。
So, there's people who take to the path of self-realization, they must be very careful to avoid contamination by the influence of Maya.
因此，走上自觉之道的人应该非常小心，不为假象影响所污染。
So, Rupa Goswami the great Acharya and disciple of Lord Chaitanya, he says that a devotee should be completely free from all kinds of material desires.
主 Chaitanya 的门徒伟大的 Acharya 圣 Rupa Goswami 说，奉献者应该完全从一切物质欲望中解放出来。
A devotee shouldn't be affected by the results of karma or jnana.
他们不应该被业报和思辨的反应所影响。
We just have to understand Krishna and carry out his desires.
人只需理解 Krishna, 执行 Krishna 的意愿。
That is a pure devotional stage.
这便是纯粹奉献的阶段。
And mystic yogis who have contaminated desires for sense gratification are never successful in their attempts to be self-realized.
仍然有感官享乐欲望被这个污染的玄密瑜伽师，他们在自我觉悟的道路上永远得不到成功。
They can never realize the super soul within themselves.
他们也不能够觉察到在他们心中的超灵。
So these so-called yogis and jnanis are simply wasting their time in different types of sense gratification.
这些所谓的瑜伽师和思辨家，只是把时间浪费在感官享乐上。
They may be enjoying mental speculation.
他们可能在享受着心意的推敲。
Or they may be making a show of some mystic power.
也许他在展示某种玄秘的力量。
But they will never be liberated from conditioned life.
但永不能从受条件限制的生命中解脱出来。
They will continue through repeated birth and death.
他们会重复不断的生死轮回。
So both this life and the next life are sources of trouble for these kind of people, these jnanis and yogis. Both this life and the next life will be trouble.
对这些瑜伽师和思辨家，此生和来世都是个麻烦。
Yeah, they're basically sinful people, and they're suffering in this life. And they're suffering in this life, and they will be plagued with further suffering in the next life.
他们从根本上来说还是罪恶之人，所以无论是在这一世还是在下一世，他们都会陷入麻烦。
They may make great efforts to attain perfection, but because they're contaminated by desires for sense gratification, they continue to suffer in this life and in the next.
他们虽然尝试达到完美境界，但因为被感官欲望所污染，所以今生和来世仍要受苦。
So, there's a comment by one of the great Acharyas, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, and he makes a comment about sannyasis meaning people who have renounced their home for self-realization.
一位伟大的 Acharya, 是的 Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, 对 sannyas 做了一个评论。Sannyas 就意味着弃绝了家庭，去从事自我觉悟。
So he says that if such people, if they don't engage themselves in the devotional service of the Lord, but they simply become attracted to philanthropic work, then they're wasting their time.
他说：“这些人倘若不从事对主的奉爱服务，而只为博爱而工作，那么他们在浪费生命。
They may do things like opening educational institutes or hospitals, or they may even open monasteries or temples or churches where they worship demigods.
他们会从事诸如开设教育机构、开设医院，甚至是建筑修院、教堂，或者是半神的庙宇。
But they'll just find only trouble in these things.
但他们只会为这些事物所困扰。
They'll have trouble in this life and in the next life also.
不单在此生，甚至来世也会为这些事物困扰。
So sannyasis are meant to take advantage of this life to realize Krishna.
Sannyasi 目标就应该用生命来觉悟 Krishna。
And if they waste their time in doing activities which are nothing to do with devotional service, then it's a waste of time.
如果他们浪费时间从事着奉爱服务以外的活动，那么他们只是在浪费时间。
So a devotee's attempt. A devotee should attempt to engage his energies in such activities as doing things like building a temple for Lord Vishnu.
奉献者会试图努力的为 Vishnu 兴建庙宇，
That kind of thing, that's not a waste of time.
这永远不是一个浪费时间。
That kind of activity, that is performed to please Krishna. So it's a devotional activity.
因为这是为了取悦 Krishna 从事的活动，所以被认为是奉爱活动。
So we should understand that somebody opens a school building. And a devotee builds a temple, they're not on the same thing. It's not the same thing.
要明白，一个人在开设学校，而奉献者在兴建庙宇，这是不同的活动。
Somebody opens a school that's a pious activity. It comes under the laws of karma.
有人开设学校，这属于虔诚活动，它要受制于业报定律。
But building a temple for Vishnu, that's devotional service.
为 Vishnu 兴建庙宇，这属于奉爱活动。
The devotional service is never under the law of karma.
奉献服务永远不在业报定律之下。
In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna describes that the devotees of the Lord overcome all the reactions of karma. And they're on the transcendental platform of Brahman when they engage in devotional service.
佛家梵歌记载，奉献者超然于业报定律之上，他们处在 Brahman 幻觉的层面之上。
So devotees are liberated both in this life and in the next life.
奉献者们今生和来世都得到解脱。
Any work done in this material world for the pleasure of Vishnu or Krishna is considered to be liberated work.
在这个世界上，为 Vishnu 或 Krishna 所做的事情都是解脱了的工作。
But if it's not connected to the Lord, then there's always a possibility of stopping. If it's not connected to the Lord, then we'll simply be under the law of karma.
如果和至尊人的守神没有关系的话，那便要受制于业报定律的反应。
So we should understand that a life in Krishna consciousness is actually a life of liberation.
我们应该明白，Krishna 知觉中的生命便是解脱了的生命。
A devotee, by the grace of the Lord, is liberated in both this life and the next.
奉献者在主的恩慈下得到了解脱，不管此生还来世都是如此。
But the karmi, the gyani, the yogi, they're never liberated, either in this life or in the next.
但业报工作者、思辨家和瑜伽师，今生和来世都得不到解脱。
So the personified Vedas continue. They say that, Dear Lord, anyone who by your grace has understood the glories of your lotus feet is not interested in material happiness or distress.
维达诸经化身继续说道：“亲爱的主，谁在你的恩慈下明白你莲花族的包容，便对物质苦乐不再感兴趣。
As long as we're within the material world, there's going to be some material pains.
我们一天在这个物质世界存在，痛物质痛苦便不可避免。”
But a devotee doesn't worry about such things.
但奉献者不理会这些事情。
He accepts, he doesn't put his attention to think about how to solve the problems or how to deal with it.
他不把注意力放在解决这些问题上，怎么解决这些问题上面。
He understands whatever's happening. It's the results of pious and impious activities.
他明白所发生的一切只是虔诚或不虔诚活动的结果。
And a devotee is not very much disturbed or pleased by praise or condemnation from other people.
对于是其他人的赞颂或谴责，一个奉献者也不会高兴，也不会不高兴。
Sometimes a devotee may be praised because of his transcendental activities.
有时候，奉献者因为其超然的活动受到世人赞颂。
And sometimes he's criticized, although there's no reason for the criticism.
有时候，奉献者也，尽管没有非议的原因，奉献者也受到批评。
But if the devotee is pure, he will not be disturbed by the praise or the condemnation by the ordinary people.
倘若奉献者是纯粹的奉献者，他对常人的赞颂或谴责并不会耿耿于怀。
The devotee's activities are on the transcendental platform.
奉献者的活动处在超然的层面上。
He's not interested in praise or being condemned.
他对于世人的毁誉没有兴趣。
If the devotee can thus maintain his transcendental position, then his liberation is assured.
如果奉献者能维持他的超然地位，那么他的解脱就得到了保证。
A devotee's transcendental position is maintained by association with pure devotees.
奉献者的超然地位是透过与纯粹的奉献者联谊保证的。
He wants to hear the glorious activities done by the Lord in different ages and in different incarnations.
他渴望聆听主在不同年代、不同化身所做的活动。
So the Krishna consciousness movement is meant for this purpose.
Krishna 知觉运动就是 特别为了这个目的。
And Srila Prabhupada quotes Narottam Das Thakur, a great acharya who has written many songs describing devotional service.
Srila Prabhupada 引述了Srila Narottam Das Thakur 的歌曲，他是一位撰写了很多歌曲的伟大 acharya。
So Narottam says, let me be engaged in your loving service.
Narottam Das Thakur 说道："让我从事对你的超然爱心服务吧。
Let me live in the association of pure devotees.
也让我活于纯粹奉献者的涟漪中。
That's my desire, life after life.
这是我生生世世的愿望。
So a devotee doesn't care whether or not he is liberated. He just wants devotional service.
奉献者不在乎解脱与否，他只关注奉爱服务。
So devotional service means one will not do anything independently of the authority of the acharyas.
奉献服务就意味着他的活动不会独立于 Acharya。
So in the Krishna consciousness movement, we are directed by acharyas like Rupa Goswami.
在 Krishna 这些运动中，我们得到 Rupa Goswami 的指导。
And by following the principles which he teaches, then a devotee is able to maintain transcendental position.
通过追随他所教导的原则，奉献者便可以保持自己的超然地位。
In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that a devotee who knows him perfectly is very dear to him.
就在《薄伽梵歌》中说："完美的了解我的奉献者，对我来说是非常亲切。
And there are four kinds of pious men who come to devotional service.
”有四种虔诚的人来到奉爱服务中。
A pious man may be in distress, and if he approaches the Lord can end his distress.
一个虔诚的人，他可能是处在痛苦之中。如果他来到 Krishna 面前，Krishna 会结束他的痛苦。
Also, a pious man may be in need of some material help, and he may pray to the Lord for help.
一个虔诚的人可能需要物质的帮助，可能向主祈求帮助。
And a pious man may be simply inquisitive about understanding the science of God.
一个虔诚的人，也许对于理解神的科学好奇爱问。
So he can approach the Supreme Lord and inquire.
他也同样可以接近至尊主，向他询问。
And finally, a pious man may be just eager to know the science of Krishna.
最后一种是一个虔诚的人，想要渴望理解 Krishna 的科学。
So he also can approach the Supreme Lord.
他也同样可以接近至尊主。
So from these four different types of people, the best one, the one who is praised by Krishna himself, is the one who comes in search of knowledge.
在这四种人当中，Krishna 最为称赞的是第四类来寻求绝对知识的人。
If someone tries to understand Krishna with full knowledge and devotion by following the acharyas, then this person is the best.
倘若谁尝试理解 Krishna，在完整的知识当中，追随 Acharya 这样的人是最优秀的。
Such a devotee like that, he can understand all conditions of life.
这样的人，
He can understand that all the conditions of life are created by the will of the Lord.
这样的人明白，生命的各种状况全是由主的至尊意志创造出来的。
And when he fully surrenders unto the lotus feet of the Lord, he won't care what his condition of life is.
他一旦全然皈依至尊主的莲花足，便不再理会他的处境。
A devotee may be in a very unfavorable condition of life, but he takes it as a special favor of the Lord.
一位奉献者可能处在非常不利的境况当中，他却把它当成是主的特别的仁慈。
Actually, there's no unfavorable condition for a devotee.
事实上，奉献者没有不利的状况。
The devotee knows that everything is coming by the will of the Lord.
奉献者知道，一切都是源于主的意志。
So he sees every condition as favorable.
所以他把任何状况都看成是有利的。
And any condition of life, he's always enthusiastic to do devotional service.
在任何生命状况中，他只是热衷于执行奉爱服务。
So we see in the Bhagavad Gita, this kind of devotee is described.
在不加梵歌当中，就解释了这种奉献者。
Lord Krishna says a devotee is never distressed, even in reverse conditions of life.
Sri Krishna 说。奉献者在逆境中也不感到痛苦。
And he is not overjoyed when the conditions are very good.
他也不为顺境而狂欢。
And in the higher stages of devotional service, a devotee is not even concerned with all the different rules and regulations, the things which you're supposed to do and things you're not supposed to do.
在奉爱服务的最高境界中，奉献者甚至对规范原则，就是该做的和该禁止的活动，他都毫不在意。
So this kind of position can be maintained only by following in the footsteps of the acharyas.
只有追随 Acharya 的步伐，才可保持这个地位。
So any action the devotee performs to do devotional service should be understood to be on the transcendental platform.
奉献者执行奉爱服务所做的任何活动，应被理解是处于超然层面上。
The Lord Krishna says that an acharya is above criticism.
Sri Krishna 说：“Acharya 应当超越批评。
And a neophyte devotee should not consider himself to be on the same plane as the acharya.
”初学的奉献者。不应自以为和 Acharya 在同一层面上。
The acharyas are on the same platform as the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Acharya 和至尊人格守神处于同一层面。
So the acharyas and Lord Krishna also should never be criticized by any person, by any neophyte devotee.
所以，初学的奉献者不应批评 Krishna，也不应批评 Acharya。
So the personified Vedas worship the Supreme Lord in different ways.
伟大经的诸位化身以不同方法崇拜至尊主。
Offering worship to the Lord can be done by praying, by remembering his transcendental qualities, pastimes, and activities.
对主的崇拜可以是通过祈祷，通过意念他的超然品质、他的逍遥、他的活动。
But the Lord's pastimes and qualities are unlimited.
但是主的逍遥和品质是无穷无尽的。
It's not possible that we can remember all the qualities of Krishna.
我们不可能铭记他的所有品质。
So the personified Vedas worship the Lord to the best of their ability.
所以韦达经的诸位化身尽可能的来崇拜主。
And then they spoke. They said to the Lord, although Lord Brahma is the predominating deity of the highest planet, Brahmaloka, and Indra is the predominating demigod of the heavenly planets, as well as the predominating deities of planets like the sun and the moon, all are very confidential directors of this material world.
他们说，虽然最高星宿 Brahma Loka 的统御神 Brahma 以及统治天堂星球的半神 Indra 和日月星体的统治半神人，全都是这个物质世界的机密的统治者。
And they have very little knowledge about you.
他们对你知道的太少。
So they don't know about you. What can ordinary human beings and mental speculators know about you?
他们都对你所知甚少，更何况普通人类和心智推敲者呢？
It's not possible for anyone to describe all the unlimited transcendental qualities which you possess.
没有人可以去数尽你的无穷无尽的超然品质。
No one, not even the mental speculators and the demigods and the higher planets, is able to understand the length and the breadth of your form and characteristics.
没有人，包括心智推敲家和高等星系的半神人在内，能真正估计你的形体的长度、宽度和特点。
And the personified Vedas say that we think that even your, we think that even your lordship doesn't have complete knowledge of your transcendental qualities.
韦达经的诸位化身说，我们认为甚至连你自己也没有关于你自己的超然品质的完整知识。
And we think that the reason for this is that you are unlimited. So how can you know the unlimited?
这个原因是因为你是无穷无尽的，所以又如何去明白一位无穷无尽的人呢？
So it's not very good to say that you don't know yourself, but it is practical to understand because you are unlimited. So very difficult to know yourself.
虽然如果说你也不太知悉你自己，这种说法不太恰当，但这是可以去实际理解的，因为你有无尽的品质和能力。
Yeah, you have unlimited qualities and energies, and your knowledge is also unlimited.
你有无穷无尽的品质和无限的能力，而你的知识也无穷无尽。
So there's unlimited competition between your knowledge and your expansion of energies.
所以你的知识和你的能力的扩展之间也有无穷尽的竞争。
So we should understand this point. that both God and his knowledge are both unlimited.
所以，我们应该去明白这一点：神和神的知识都是无穷无尽的。
So as soon as God knows his, as soon as God knows some of his energy, as soon as God knows his energies, he understands that he has still more energies.
一旦当神察悉到他自己的一些能力时，他也看到自己还有另一些能力。
Both his energies and his knowledge are increasing.
他的能力和知识都在不断增长。
And because both of them are unlimited, there's no end to the energies and no end to the knowledge.
因为这两者都是无穷无尽的，他的能力是无穷无尽的，他的知识也无边无际。
This knowledge is what the Lord uses to understand the energies.
所以，这门知识就用来你去理解它的能量。
So God is omniscient, he knows everything. But the personified Vedas say that even God himself doesn't know everything about his energies.
虽然神是无所不知的，但伟达经的人格化身说，甚至神也不知道他自己能力的极限。
So this doesn't mean that God doesn't know everything.
这并不是说神不是无所不知的。
An actual fact may be unknown to a person. So that is called ignorance or lack of knowledge.
当人不知道一件事实的真相时，便称它是愚昧的或缺乏知识。
So this doesn't apply to God.
但是这对神并不适用。
He knows himself perfectly.
神完全了解自己。
But as his energies and his activities increase, he also increases his knowledge to understand them.
随着神的能力和活动增加，他也增加知识来理解。
So both are increasing unlimitedly.
所以二者都在无穷无尽的增长。
And there's no end to it.
而且，这也无边无际。
So in that way, we say that God himself does not know the limit of his energies or his qualities.
由此，便说到，甚至神自己也不知道自己的能力与品质的边际。
So we can understand how God is unlimited in his expansion of energies and activities. It can be calculated by any sane and sober person.
任何清醒审慎的生物都可以略微的计算出神的能力扩展和活动究竟是怎样无穷无尽的。
It's said in the Vedic literatures that there are innumerable universes coming from the body of Mahavishnu when he exhales.
伟达文献记载说，当 Mahavishnu 呼气的时候，便发出无数的宇宙。
All right, Mahavishnu lays in yoga nidra, or mystic sleep. And at that time, the universes come out from the pores of his body.
Mahavishnu 就在玄秘瑜伽的睡眠当中躺在那里，这时候他无数的宇宙便释放出来。
And when he inhales, then they all enter back into his body again.
当他吸气时，无数宇宙再次进入他的躯体内。
So we have to understand that according to our limited knowledge, these universes are expanded unlimitedly. And they're so great that the gross and the subtle ingredients are not only within the universe, but cover the universe also in layers.
这些粗糙元素和精微元素不仅是在宇宙之内，而且是一层一层地覆盖着这些宇宙。
So gross elements are earth, water, fire, air, and sky.
粗糙元素有土、水、火、空气和天空。
And then you have the total material energy and the false ego, which are subtle.
还有整体的物质元素，还有自我这种精微元素。
So these things, they're in the universe, and at the same time, they cover the universe.
这些元素不仅在宇宙之中，而且还是覆盖着宇宙。
So each and every universe is very securely packed.
每一个宇宙这样便紧密地包裹着，
And there's an infinite number of universes.
而且有无穷无尽的数不胜数的宇宙。
And all these universes float within the pores of the body of Mahavishnu.
所有这些宇宙都浮游于马哈维什努的超然躯体的毛孔之上。
And just as the atoms and the dust are floating within the air, along with the birds, their number cannot be calculated.
原子、尘埃、鸟儿一起漫游于空气之中，它们都是不可胜数的。
In the same way, there's innumerable universes floating within the pores of the body of the Lord.
同样，无数的宇宙也浮游于主的躯体的毛孔之中。
So, for this reason, the Vedas say God is beyond our ability to understand by knowledge.
因为这个缘故。韦达经说：“神超然于我们的知识范畴以外。
To try to understand the length and the breadth of God is beyond the power of our mind.
”要理解主的长度与宽度，实在超乎我们心意的推敲范畴以外。
So a person who is actually learned and sane, he will not claim to be God.
因此，真正博学、神智清醒的人，不会自称为神。
But he will try to understand God.
他会尝试着去理解神。
And he will try to distinguish between what is matter and what is spirit.
他会努力去分辨灵性与物质。
In this way, he can understand that the Supreme Soul is transcendental to both the supreme and inferior energies.
这样便可清晰地明白，至尊灵魂超越于高等和低等的能力。
He has a direct connection with both of them.
他和这两种能力有着直接的联系。
So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains everything is resting on his energies.
在博家梵歌当中，主 Krishna 解释说，万事万物栖息于他的能力之上。
At the same time, he is different or separate from the energy.
与此同时，他和他的能力有所不同，并且是分开的。
So nature and the living entities are sometimes called prakriti and the parusha, respectively. Nature is called prakriti, the living entities are called parusha, sometimes.
有时候，自然被称为是 prakriti，生物被称为是 purusha。
So the whole material creation is a combination of the living entities and nature.
整个物质宇宙展示便是由自然和生物体组成。
Nature is the cause of the material creation.
自然是物质创造的根源。
And the living entities are the effective cause.
而生物体是影响之源。
So these two causes combine together, and the effect is the material world.
这两种原因组合，结果便导致了这个宇宙展示。
So sometimes some person may be fortunate and they may come to the right understanding about this material world and understand everything that's going on within this material world.
有时候人会特别有幸，他明白到有关这个宇宙展示的正确结论和这个宇宙展示之间运行万物的正确结论。
And he knows that everything is caused directly and indirectly by the Supreme Lord.
他知道，他们都直接或间接的是由至尊歌手神所产生的。
In the Brahma Samhita, we learn that Krishna is the cause of all causes, and he's the supreme controller.
在 Brahma Samhita 当中，我们知道 Krishna 是万源之源，是至高无上的控制者。
So when we come to the perfection of knowledge, then we come to understand that Krishna or God is the original cause of everything.
当我们到达完美的知识阶段，便得出结论：Krishna 是万源之源。
So it does not matter how big he is or how wide he is.
所以，无论它的长度和宽度都如是什么样的都无所谓。
We shouldn't waste our time thinking about these things.
我们不应该浪费时间来考虑这些事情。
We should simply come to understand that Krishna is the cause of all causes. That is the perfection of knowledge.
我们只需要去明白，Krishna 是万源之源，这便是完美的知识。
So in this way, the Vedanta, the Veda stuti, or the prayers offered by the personified Vedas, were offered to Garbhodakshayi Vishnu.
这样，韦达经的注意化身向 Garbhodakshayi Vishnu 所做出祈祷。
And these prayers were then narrated in the disciplic succession by Sanandan to his brothers. Sanandan means one of the four Kumaras. He narrated it to his brothers.
这些祈祷，便是在使徒传记当中，由库马尔兄弟当中的萨南达向他的兄弟们阐释了。
Right, the four Kumaras were the firstborn sons of Brahma.
四位库马尔兄弟是 Brahma 的第一批儿子。
So sometimes they're known as Purva Jata, meaning the first sons.
有时候他们以 Pravajata 而著称，意思是头生的子嗣。
So this parampara system begins with Krishna himself.
这个使徒传系是始于 Krishna 本人。
So the prayers of the personified Vedas is understood that the parampara system began also with the Supreme Lord, Narayana Rishi.
在韦达经诸位化身的祷文中，可以明白到，使徒传系由人格首神 Narayana Rishi 开始。
We should remember that this prayer is spoken by Sanandan Kumar.
我们要记得这部祷文首先是萨南达库马尔阐述的。
And then what he spoke was repeated by Narayana Rishi in Badarik Ashram.
他所说的又由 Badarik Ashram 的 Narayana Rishi 转述。
Narayana Rishi is the incarnation of Krishna, and he shows us the path of self-realization.
Narayana Rishi 是 Krishna 的化身，他向我们展示了自我觉悟之途。
And he undergoes great austerities for self-realization.
他从事严格的苦行来从进行自我觉悟。
So in this age, Lord Chaitanya, he showed us the path of pure devotional service.
在这个年代，主柴他俩向我们展示了纯粹奉爱服务之徒。
He put himself in the role of a pure devotee.
他扮演了一位纯粹奉献者的角色。
So in the same way, in the past, Lord Narayana Rishi was an incarnation of Krishna who did great austerities in the Himalayas.
同样的，主拿瑞那 Rishi 就在喜马拉雅山从事了严苛的苦行。
And Narada Muni was hearing from him.
而拿的目的就从他那里聆听。
So the statement given by Narayana Rishi to Narada Muni was told by Sanandan Kumar. It was told in the form of the prayers by the personified Vedas.
主拿然的 Rishi 向拿尔的穆尼传授的道和，其次又由库马尔萨南达库马尔的韦达祷文，
And it's
又
understood, Veda, that one, And
从
it's
这个祷文
understood,
当中可以知道，sorry。
And it's understood that God is the supreme and all others are his servants.
而是人，嗯，世人便明白神是至尊，而其他的都是他的仆人。
All right, so we're going to stop here today.
那我们今天就讲到这里。看下的
Are
问
there
题。
any other questions?
Yes. Lila Rani Sita 说：“顶拜 Guru，所有生物都是 Krishna 的展示。”从事博爱工作，服务其他生物体，为什么不能取悦 Krishna 呢？为什么服务奉献者取悦 Krishna？是因为奉献者在服务 Krishna 吗？非奉献者也在服务啊，他们是在被迫服务。 只是奉献者在主动服务。So Guru, all living entities are exhibition of Krishna. They are carrying out the work, philanthropic work. May I ask why serving other living entities cannot please Krishna? Why serve devotees can please Krishna? Is that devotees are serving Krishna, but non-devotees are also serving Krishna, by force, they are also serving Krishna, only that the devotees are voluntarily serving Krishna, but non-devotees, they are serve Krishna by force.
Well,
So
the non-devotees are serving, you could say they're serving Krishna indirectly, not directly.
非奉献者他们是间接在服务 Krishna，而不是直接的服务 Krishna。
If someone engages in philanthropic activities like opening a school or maybe opening a kitchen to distribute food for the poor, then that is not the highest. That is a pious activity, but it's not a spiritual activity.
有人他开设学校，或者是他开一个厨房去给穷人提供食物，这是属于虔诚活动的范畴，而不是灵性的活动。
Lord Krishna is pleased when he sees someone engage in spiritual activities. When you perform pious activities, that is temporary benefit for some people.
主 Krishna 喜欢看到有人在从事灵性的活动，从事虔诚活动，虔诚活动是短暂的，它只能带来短暂的好处。
How many people are you able to care for? How many people are you able to feed? A very, very small percentage of the planet.
你能关心多少人呢？你能给多少人提供食物呢？那只不过是这个星球上的一小部分，只是很少的百分比。
But if you engage in devotional service, if you engage in acts of devotion for the pleasure of the Supreme Lord, then that is beneficial to all living entities everywhere.
倘若从事了奉献服务的活动，这就会取悦至尊主。这将给所有的地方的所有的生物带来好处。
Lord Krishna is in the heart of all living entities.
主 Krishna 居于众生的心中。
So when you serve Krishna, you're doing acts which are beneficial for all living entities.
如果你为 Krishna 从事活动的话，那么，这能对于所有的生物体都给带来好处。
Just like when you water a plant, you put the water on the root, and then by watering the root, the water will be distributed to all the leaves and branches.
就好像你给一个植物浇水，如果是把水浇到树根，那么所有的枝枝叶叶都得到滋养。
But if you engage in activities just simply for the pleasure of a few people, that is just like watering some leaf or some branches of the tree. It's not going to do any real good for the tree. You have to water the root.
如果你只是为了几个人的快乐而活动的话，这就好比是给个树的树枝和树叶浇水，你不能给这树带来真正的好处，除非你给树根浇水。
Yes. Just like feeding the body, you have to put the food into the stomach. And then when you feed the stomach, then the energy is distributed to all the parts of the body.
就好像你在给这个身体食物的时候，必须把食物送到胃里，这样的能量呢，才能被分发到全身。
So we need to get, we have to understand that by serving Lord Krishna, we're actually satisfying all living entities.
所以我们要明白，通过服务主 Krishna，我们就能够满足所有的生物。
But if you engage in just simply some welfare activity, you make a school, or you make a hospital, or you do some work for the poor, you're only helping very few people for in a very temporary way.
如果你从事像开办学校、医院，喂养穷人这样的福利工作，你只能服务几个人，而且是很短暂的服务。
But when we serve Lord Krishna, it's eternal benefit for all living entities.
如果我们服务的是 Krishna，那么就给所有的生物体带来的是永恒的好处。
This is a very important point for you to understand.
所以这一点非常重要，你应该去理解。
We want you to appreciate this.
我们希望你能够欣赏到这一点。
Okay.
下一个问题是来自于快乐的泉源说，在世的灵性导师能否被称为是二叉元？This devotee is asking, can we call the spiritual master, the present spiritual master, as Acharya?
No, we do not usually do that.
一般我们不这么去做。
We do refer to Srila Prabhupada as the founder Acharya.
我们确实称呼 Srila Prabhupada 为奠基。创办灵性导师。
You have to understand that the title Acharya is given to somebody who is very much superior to all the devotees. He's in a very senior, very advanced position.
我们要明白，Acharya 的头衔呢，是给一位，就是在所有奉献者。这上面的这位人物，他是一个特别的有资格、特别进步的人物。
Acharya means one who teaches by example.
Acharya 的这个字面意思是以身作则来教导他人。
So it's generally not a title which is given to the spiritual masters, although there may be exceptions.
所以一般而言，这头衔，不是授予那些灵性导师们，当然也有例外。
In the past, there were titles like that given to some of our spiritual masters, but in course of time, it was seen that sometimes the spiritual master would get into difficulties.
在过去。我们把这些头衔呢，也授予了一些灵性导师们，但随着时间推移，我们发现呢，他们自身的陷入困境当中。
So it was considered inappropriate that we give these kind of names to spiritual teachers if they're not well established in Krishna consciousness.
所以呢，我们就发现， 不适合把这个头衔授予在世的灵性导师，除非他们是完全稳固的处在 Krishna 知觉当中。
We don't know who's fully established in Krishna consciousness. It's difficult to judge.
我们也不知道谁是完全的稳处于 Krishna 知觉当中，这是一个很难来评判的。
Sometimes a person seems to be very strong in Krishna consciousness, but then somehow they get into some difficulty.
有时候，某个人看上去好像是在 Krishna 知觉很强而有力的，但是接着他们自己又会遇到困境。
We always have to be praying to Krishna. Please protect me. Please don't let me fall into Maya.
我们要总是向 Krishna 祈祷说，请保护我，请不要让我堕入玛雅假象当中。
Maya is Krishna's energy, so it's very powerful.
玛雅是 Krishna 的能量，是强而有力的。
Okay.
好，下一个问题是，还是 Lidarani，顶拜 Guru。至尊主的不同能量可以相互转换，凭他的意愿把外在能量转为内在能量。个体灵魂从物质界回归灵性世界是一种能量转换吗？从边缘能量变成内在能量。物质自然是外在能量，在物质世界没有灵性知觉，在灵性世界一切事物都灵性化、人格化。这是不是意味着物质自然在物质世界作为外在能量？在灵世界作为内在能量，obeisance to guru。The Supreme Lord, the different energies of the Supreme Lord can change interchange with each other. By his will, he can change the material. Oh, he can change the external energy into internal energy. And may I ask, the individual soul, in the individual souls, they return back to the spiritual world from material world. Is it also a change, an interchange of energy? This is the first question.
Is it an interchange of energy? Well, the spirit soul is going back to the spiritual world. You could say he's changing from a Nityabada, from an eternally conditioned soul, he's becoming a Nityamukta soul, a liberated soul, an eternally liberated soul. So the eternally conditioned soul can become an eternally liberated soul. But they're always souls. The energy that they don't change their energy. They're still energy. They're still tatastha shakti. The living entity is tatastha, marginal.
可以说，他仅是从一个 Nityabada 就永恒受条件限制的灵魂，变成了一位 Nityamukta 永恒解脱了的灵魂。但是个体灵魂，它总是个体灵魂，它永远都是 Tathasta Shakti 边际能量。
So the living entity can live under the material energy or under the spiritual energy. As a conditioned soul, he's under the Bahiranga Shakti. But as a liberated soul in the spiritual world, he enters into the Antaranga Shakti.
个体灵魂，它可以是处在物质能量之下，就是 Bahiranga Shakti。那它回到灵性世界，它就处在内在能量之下，Antaranga Shakti。She's also asking, can the living entity change from Tathasta Shakti into Antaranga Shakti, internal energy.
Well, he's still Tathasta. He will always be Tathasta.
它永远都是边际能量。
But he can reside either under the material energy or the spiritual
它可以或者居住在内在能量之下，或者是外在能量之下，
energy.
物质自然是外在能量。The material energy is the external energy. In 物质世界没有灵性之 immaterial world。There is no spiritual consciousness, but in spiritual world, everything is spiritual, is personified. Does that mean that the material energy in the material world, the material energy, they act as the external energy, but in the spiritual world, it is act as the internal energy.
What acts as external and internal? What are we
In
talking about? What acts as the external energy and as the internal energy?
Lila Rani Sita，你举手了，你可以开麦说吧。我听看不懂您的问题。
Hello Krishna，顶拜 Guru，我就是想问一问那个能量，因为 Krishna 的能量它是同一种能量，它既可以把它作为内在能量，也可以把它作为外在能量，或者是做成边缘能量。那意思就是 Krishna 所有的能量是按照 Krishna 的意愿，他想让这种能量成为什么样的能量，就可以成为什么样的能量。所以我问的是两个问题，一个问题就是我们个体灵魂作为 Jiva Shakti。那么我们是属于边缘能量，但是那在 Krishna 身边有很多木流姑娘或者是 Radha Rani，这些是他的内在能量。我就是想问，这种能量之间是可以互相转换的吗？但是刚才 Guru 说，意思是我们这种边缘能量就是 Jiva Shakti 是不会转变的，永远都是边缘能量。但是实际在经典里面描述的是，Krishna 可以把同一种能量做成所有其他的不同的能量来展示。这是我刚才问的第一个问题。第二个问题，刚才说的物质自然，它是作为一个外在能量，在物质世界，它作为外在能量，它是没有人格性的，它就是一个不动的物。但是在灵性世界，所有的这些物不动的，它都是具有人格化的，哪怕一杯牛奶、一棵树，它也具有人格化，它也具有这种人格的这种能量，可以说话、可以沟通、可以交流的。那但是它们都是属于物质自然的这种能量，为什么在物质世界是不能有人格化的，但是灵性世界有人格化了，那是不是就意味着它在物质世界是一种能量，而在灵性世界是另外一种能量呢？哈利克什那，我说清楚了吗？翻译。
第一个问题已经回答您了吧？
对，
就
我
是
们已
对
经回答第一个问题。
已经
第一
很
个问
清
题
楚
是
了。
Guru 回答了，但我还是有点困惑。Guru 的意思就是说，我们个体灵魂作为边缘能量是不会改变的，就永远都是边缘能量。可是 Krishna 的能量它不是可以变换的吗？就是那为什么这个个体灵魂就永远是边缘能量呢？它不可以变换成其，就是在 Krishna 的旨意下，它不能够变成其他的能量吗？哈利·克什纳，
在说什么？
这已经回答了。She's asking, that the jivas cannot change into bahi aranga shakti and antaranga shakti. Why?
Because that's not the nature. They are, they have the constitutional nature.
这是他们的构成性地位，对，是一个个体灵魂，它就是这样的构成性地位。
They live either under the, either they reside under the Antaranga Shakti or under the Bahiranga Shakti.
因为它很渺小，它就或者是在外在能量的控制之下，或者在内在能量控制之下。
But they retain that Tattvic nature.
但它的构成性地位，它宪法性地位，它就是这个外在
Because
Tathasta Shakti。
they're very small, they're very, very small, so they can easily be overcome by the material energy.
因为它的那的尺寸它太渺小了，它非常非常的微不足道，所以很容易就被物质能量所以覆盖了。
You have to understand the difference between the super soul and the individual soul.
你要明白，超灵和个体灵魂是有天壤区别的。
The super soul never falls down, but the individual soul can fall down.
超灵永不堕落，但个体灵魂是容易堕落的。这回答您的问题了吗？
谢，这个听懂了。刚才姑姑说这个，我明白了。第一个问题可以了，第二个问题可以麻烦你给姑姑翻译一下吗？哈利·克什纳，你
您
听懂
是
我
我
说的第二个问题意思了吗？
没听懂，
再说一遍啊，再说一遍，麻烦你一下。就是那个，就是不是我们这个物质自然，比如说我们在物质自然里面有些什么桌子呀、树木呀，然后这些东西不动的，它就不是人格化的，它没有自己的思想，也不能够表达，
你
它就
慢
作为一
点
个外。
说，这桌子
慢
树，
一点，让他给我翻译。你说一句话，让他翻译，我要听清楚。
好的，咕噜，好的，咕噜，
In the
就
material
是。
world, the tables and the trees, they are immovable.
Yeah. But there's a difference between the table and the tree. The table has no consciousness. The tree has consciousness.
虽然桌子和树都不移动，但桌子和树是有区别的呀。比如说，桌子它是没有知觉，但树是有知觉的呀。
Right? The tree is a living entity. The table is just dead matter.
对吧？那树是生物，活的生物，但桌子是死的物质。
还是亏是了，是这样的，我知道，就是桌子是死物，树是活的，但是呢，不论桌子还是树木，他们在物质世界，他们都不像人一样可以交流嘛，就是他没有人格化，但是在灵性世界，无论
But
是
the tables and trees, they are not person.
桌子，who?
The tables and the trees in the material world, they are not like in the spiritual world, is personified, has the
Well, the trees are living
personality.
entities. The trees are persons. The trees are living entities.
树是有人格化的，树是本身就是生物。
Flowers and plants and trees, they're all living entities.
花儿、植物、树都是活生物，
They're like our brothers and sisters.
他们就像兄弟姐妹。
那好吧，我都重新换一个说法。那我们不说树木嘛，就说牛奶或者桌子嘛。在物质世界，牛奶或
慢点儿，
好，
牛奶是。
在物质世界。牛奶和桌子，它是没有人格化的，不会说话，也不会表达意愿，也不会成长，也不会长大。但是在灵
But the
性，
milk 是
and
but the
fruit。
milk and table in the material world they cannot grow, they cannot speak.
Yeah.
好，您接着
但是。
说。
但是呢，这桌子或者牛奶，但是在灵性世界，它就是具有人格化的，它有自
But
己
in
的
the
意愿。
spiritual world, the milk and the tables, they have personality. They can speak. They can think.
Okay.
然后我的问题就是，他们这两种在物质世界和灵性世界不同的状态。是不是就意味着他们在物质世界和灵性世界代表不同的能量？哈利·克里斯那，谢谢您，谢谢咕噜。
So my question is that, the different conditions of the milk and tables in material world and spiritual world, whether or not they represent the different energies.
Well, you have to understand that in the spiritual world, there are pure souls there who take the form of things like they take forms such as milk and tables for the service of Krishna because they simply desire to serve Krishna in that way.
所以你要明白的一点就是说，在灵性世界有纯粹的灵魂，他们的形象就是牛奶、桌子这样的形象来服务 Krishna，因为他们就想以这种方式来服务 Krishna。
So everything in the spiritual world, as you say, has consciousness. So even the table and the milk and so on, they have consciousness. It indicates that consciousness is coming from person, from a living entity, from an individual spirit soul, which desires to serve Krishna in that way.
就像您说的，在灵性世界，一切是有知觉的，所以这表明就是有知觉的个体灵魂，他们就以这种形象展现来服务，以这种特定的方式去服务 Krishna。
哦，还有 Krishna，谢谢 Guru。
好的，那我们去看下一个问题。是 Jagat Mohan，亲爱的 Guru，顶拜您，在世的奉献者走之前，能达到较完美或比较纯粹的可能吗？如果能，必须做到主要哪几点？如不能，还有多大差距？顶拜 Guru。Dear Guru, I'll listen to you. Before, passing away, can the devotees attain perfection, or is there any possibility for them to attain perfection or become very pure? If they can, what's their characteristics? What should they do? If they cannot, what's the distance between the present situation and the state of perfection or the state of very pure?
Well, have you spoken the Chinese? Did you read it?
Already.
Okay, so we understand that the perfectional stage is that devotee is fixed in consciousness of Krishna and remembrance of the Lord by hearing the holy name and by chanting the holy name.
所以这种完美的境界呢，就体现在奉献者就觉知到 Krishna，他能记住主，他通过聆听圣名，唱诵圣名。
And we also see devotees dedicate their lives, not just only at the moment of death, but they've dedicated like throughout their life to the service of the Lord.
而且呢，奉献者他这一生都奉献来服务主，而不仅仅是在死亡的那一片刻。
So it's not just a matter of judging how devotee passes from the world, but you have to see how they've dedicated their life also to the service of the Lord.
所以这不是一个，就是说，一味的单独的来评判奉献者如何离开这个世界的这个片面的事情，而是看他这一生他是如何奉献他这一生来做服务的。
So, we want to understand how to see a devotee successfully leave the material body. And success is that they've dedicated their life to the service of Krishna. They've remained steady in their service to Krishna.
所以奉献者他想要成功的离开物质躯体的话，那他这一生都应该服务 Krishna，稳定的处在对 Krishna 的服务当中。
And devotees will naturally like to help that devotee in the final stages of the life when they depart from the world. Just like we saw Srila Prabhupada, he left the body in Vrindavan. He was happy to go back to Vrindavan, to leave his body in Vrindavan. So leaving the body in a holy place is important. It helps to make it easier for us to go back to Godhead.
奉献者们也自然的喜欢帮助其他奉献者，在临终的时刻，我们看到施乐普帕的，他很高兴能够回到文达文离开，能在圣地离开，这也是重也也是也也重要的，他能够帮助奉献者很容易的回归。
But if a devotee leaves his body, if he leaves his body while he's in the service of Krishna, he may not be in a holy place, but he's traveling in the service of Krishna, then that is also auspicious.
倘若奉献者在服务 Krishna 的时候离开躯体，也许不在圣地，也许在旅行的过程当中，这也是吉祥的。
And certainly Lord Krishna will remember him, that even if he's not remembered Krishna at the time of death, but if he's dedicated his life to the service of the Lord, then the Lord will not forget him.
主 Krishna 肯定也会记住这样的人。也许呢，这位奉献者临终之际呢，想不起主，但是因为他一生都在服务主，所以主会记住他的。
Okay.
OK，下一问题是 Vaishnava Vani。We read, a devotee can understand that all conditions of life, favorable or unfavorable, are created by the supreme will of the Lord. Is this statement applied only to the pure devotees who have fully surrendered to Lord Krishna? Because the Lord is not responsible responsible for the unfavorable or favorable conditions because it is created by our own thoughts or karma. Is it like when we try to do devotional service, Lord Krishna modifies our karma, creates situations by which we can do more devotional service, my humble businesses?
Well, yes, definitely it's true that Lord Krishna creates the situation so that we can do more devotional service.
是的，这肯定是确实的。Krishna 会制造一种境况，好让我们从事更多的服务。
Yeah, and it's also true what you said that Lord Krishna makes special arrangements for his pure devotees. Sometimes we put them in what seems like unfavorable conditions. But Prabhupada pointed out, actually, nothing is unfavorable. A devotee sees everything as the arrangement of Lord Krishna.
就像您说的，Krishna，可能会安排一位纯粹的奉献者处于不利的处境，但是圣帕帕的指出，没有什么是不利的，奉献者把一切都看作是主 Krishna 的安排。
Now somebody sees, may think, oh, this is like my karma. Yeah, but you know, a devotee will think it's my karma. A devotee will also think it's my karma, but it can also be understand that karma is also arranged, but it's under the direction of Lord Krishna.
一位奉献者可能会说：“哎，这都是我的自己的业报导致的。”但是业报也是在 Krishna 的指挥，也是在 Krishna 的指挥之下。
So what's important is that we go on with our devotional service despite conditions, whether they're favorable or unfavorable. That's our mind. Our mind is thinking, oh, this is favorable, but the same mind could think this is unfavorable. It's just a condition of our mind.
重要的是，我们要继续做服务，不管是有利还是不利的。是，其实这个有利和不利呢，也都是我们心意在作祟，是我们心意的一种受条件的，心意在受条件限制。
So accepting everything is Krishna's arrangement for us to increase our devotional service. That is the Krishna conscious vision.
所以，把一切都接受为是 Krishna 安排的，来增加我们的奉献服务，这是 Krishna 直觉的，一种视角。
Okay, yeah. There's a verse in Srimad Bhagavatam which says, Tate Nukampam Sushamikshamana Vanjana Evatma Kritam Pipa. The verse is saying that one who tolerates all kinds of adverse conditions but accepts them to be reactions due to his past deeds, but he goes on engaging in my devotional service. Then that person becomes qualified to be my unalloyed devotee.
就在是那部教堂，应该是第十篇，第八章第14节就说的，这个世界说，谁要是容忍发生在他身上的逆境，同时接受过往活动的结果，从而继续做奉献服务，这样的人有资格成为纯粹的奉献者。
The word is used, dayabak. Dayabak means that it becomes your rightful claim. And the qualification to claim is that you stay alive in devotional service.
这里用了一个梵文词叫 dayabhag， 意思是说，一个人正当的这个正当的要求，那一个人谈到他，提出他正当的要求的话，前提条件他是他的资格就是他得活在奉献服务当中，他在奉献服务当中他存活着。
And we understand that just like your father may be a rich man, so what does the son have to do to inherit the money of the father? The son just has to stay alive and wait for the father to die. And in course of time, the son inherits the wealth of the father.
有一个比方，就好像是，父亲很有钱，然后儿子呢，他就可以继承父亲的这个财产。儿子的资格是他得活着，他等着父亲去世，他才可以继承父亲的遗产。
So, the same way, if you stay alive in Krishna consciousness, then it becomes your right to go back to Godhead.
同样的，你得活在 Krishna，在 Krishna 的世界当中，得继续活下去，这样才有权利回归神手。
Okay.
Okay. That's all the question for tonight.
Oh, thank you very much. Woman Ganshi Guru Mani, Ki Woman Fani, Woman Ganshi Functions of Ling Ting, Woman Yajufani Man, Ha Ha Nin Song, Wan An, Hare Krishna, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you, Guru Mani, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. 非常感谢圣巴迪维那什纳辛哈马尔给我们带来的讲课，谢谢奉献者聆听。晚安，Hare Krishna。